I have a hard time.
Every translation, every PNH signal. Every ship has an IC signal. This is a sequence-based feature. The team was just trying to figure out how to make a correlation between the answer. It's how you seen. And you can combine all that into the forest machinery. So you can see that, again, black is correlation alone. And orange is everything is consistent with correlation. And then this purple line is red forest using the minimal model of the features that I mentioned in the previous slide. So you can see, you see a marked improvement. This is rock curve and even more drastic improvement for the rock curve. And this is really the vision here a lot about. And you see a very big improvement. And you can look to record if you quantification as to which feature I put. So the most important actually is the most used feature. And you know that you see a lot of promoter features contribute quite a bit, slightly more than the feature take on the angle. So I mentioned that for some of the angle cell types, you can have a comprehensive model, and here we just want to share a little bit of results on gene expression. So how well can you do when you add other, you know, other features and specific gene expression? That really helps. So when you add the gene expression, now you get this purple line. It's definitely better in marker, and it's again markedly better in marker. So if you look at the feature contribution.
Microphone. Yeah, the microphone is coming. So,
I guess this is just a little bit of elaboration on the question that we're just being asked. So if, you know, I want to run this analysis on a bunch of them, I understand and I get your point that if we have these and a bunch of like four or five types of channels, at least you can make 100 minutes, then okay, I can go one by one and visualize this and therefore structure. But if I was to class it like 50,000 or, you know, you're saying that's way too many, way too many. Is there a way to access or like will this code be or available for us to be able to use and further shortlist? So the visualization tool we have built, you could download the data, if you choose, so we will make some available, but also, I think we should allow people to upload a file to signify the list of regions. Would that address your question again? Okay, so we can easily use that functionality. So you can upload, like, a band file to 3,000 regions, and then we can download the stuff. Okay, thank you much.
So it's my great pleasure to introduce Cricket Sloan. Cricket is the lead data wrangler here at Stanford at DCC. If you don't know what a lead data wrangler does, she's pretty much the most important person in the OASIS project. So I'll let you. She's going to talk today about our website and our methods for accessing data.
Hello. I'm going to have a moment with my So I am excited to talk to you guys about the ENCODE portal, and I wanted to start out with the fact that unlike the previous talks, I actually have already put out demos. This is intended to be a workshop where you actually are poking around in our site. The demonstrations are really simple. They're just, you know, making sure that you have the functionality to interpret what you're seeing on our site and navigate through the site.
Bad idea. Because the initial curriculum can be done by individuals. So if you have a team of five students,
And there's lots of visitors greeted with the material. She or he can say, what are you doing? And the artist can free write. And the person who's doing all the work is annoyed that the other people are free writing, and the people are free writing are learning anything. Level one for Finnish learning is, make it so hard that even the best student in the class cannot solve it on this level. So for a lot of the individual parts of the group, scores, instead of being, you know, in the 80, 90, or whatever high percent, tend to range around the 50 to maybe even 40%. So even the best student says, well, I'm not sure I can do this. And the other students know, well, she might be the brightest student in the class, but there's no certainty that what she says is correct. In that case, everybody has to pitch in. Everybody has to work together. Okay, so how do you go about designing a course like that? I decided to apply something I already tried to apply to an existing course, but it's very difficult to do to an existing course. And this is how Weinenberg already advocates this approach, that code design. Start from the output rather than the input. Instead of saying, in this course we're going to cover this content, ask yourself, what do I want to cover next? It's very well described in this book by Frank Rittes, Understanding by Design. The idea is that you start with desired outcomes. And you ask yourself, what am I going to accept as evidence that I've accomplished these outcomes? And that's really what conceptual approach that I'm going to develop in order to maximize the output. Makes a lot of sense, but for somebody who was for many years taught by looking at content, something that they couldn't see, actually wanted to get a book. So what I did was I surveyed all of the faculty here at Harvard who teaches a course that requires a course in physics department, in the engineering department, in chemistry, in biology. And I asked them about the output that they thought would be a good design outcome for the physics course, as well as we got about 30 faculty who to design a response. And I was saying a set of lists, a set of outcomes if you want, in three layers. At the top layer is a list of companies. I'm not going to go into details, I'll give you a link to download it if you want to look at it. These competencies have nothing to do with the course per se. Ideally, I would like to see these competencies across the curriculum. They involve things specific to the background like design and quantitative analysis, qualitative analysis, and so on. Below that layer, I have a set of course goals, and the course goals fall into four broad categories. I want the students to be able to engage in self-directed learning. After all, learning how to learn is probably the most important skill in any education. When we give our students a diploma, that's not when learning ends. That's when it really starts. And unless we equip them with skills to continue to not only learn, but also assess themselves, it'll be hard to progress. I want them to master the knowledge. I want them to be able to engage in effective teamwork, and I want them to exhibit professional skills, including ethics and functionality and participation in business. And then, of course, there's a very much longer list of specific content goals, which, stands for the research basis, and I'd like to share those with you. In fact, if you're ever interested in visiting the course, our visitor packet is at the URL, not at the URL at the end of my talk here, that this is all the details possibly like that. Just have to think that it's clear, well, then I have to change the architecture of the group. This is a room which I've been teaching for many, many years, and I've been doing this course, some sort of thing you'll see. And you only have to look at this to see that it's completely focused on information transfer and on the faculty member in front, whereas most important people in the classroom are students, not the professor in front. So anyway, who's responsible for this argument? No, it's not professors. Where does it come from? The Greek is factory, the ancient Greek design, the amphitheater. What did they design the amphitheater for? So plays exactly. Did they teach that way? No. As you look at an illustration of the School of Athens, you see a very different picture. You see people walking around, they talk and discuss. The Sistine Chapel is a beautiful painting of the School of Athens. So, the Greeks knew darn well not to use the performance phase as a learning space, but somewhere in medieval Europe we adopted the performance phase as a learning space, and teaching became, in a sense, a performance act. So we had a library in Pierce Hall on the third floor that was not heavily used. I decided to reduce the area of the library and to redesign that room as a learning space. I also had a committee to redesign it. I was also on the committee for the 21st century classroom of the university. One of the first projects was to redesign the classroom in Stone Hall, which became the innovation room. And it was sort of interesting to go through that process. Initially, we had they were putting in a lot of technology the same way MIT has a routine to classroom, but then we decided that we don't know how people use technology. Let's just get focused on the aesthetics of the room and the organization of the room. The room has only mobile furniture. It can be arranged in tables that accommodate 6 people or 8 people or 12 people, depending on how many tables you put together. It's a beautiful space. It has windows all around. This created a problem because we couldn't put whiteboards. They would have been covering up the windows. They're on 3 sides. You only see one side that has windows, and the only side that does not have windows. The other have even more windows than you see there, which makes the space very attractive. Except we bought these mobile boards, which is a few of them, and most of them have been moved away in order to be able to take the picture. It turns out those mobile boards were the best possible thing. Because now, if you're in that room, even if you would like to lecture, you can't. Not only do half the students have their back towards you, 80% of them are hidden by a board that people are going to be throughout the space. So this space is focused on the direction, and our students have to run in these. I think the microphone is just an item of the picture. She's going to pay attention to it. It's very disconcerting at first, but once you come to terms with the fact that you no longer start on the board, it's actually probably a very good one. So I decided also, right off the bat, I would not have any lectures, can't mention that board, and also no exams. I'd love to talk about that. Some of you here know that the bottom is this board, assessment. If you want to know why I eliminate the exams, I urge you to watch the video of the top board assessment beside the killer there. The idea is I want to take away the most effective for the exam. I want to take away the most for the exam. So, obviously I was going to use what is now known as the flipped classroom, which I started back as you mentioned. Initially, in the traditional curriculum, you start in the classroom with the first exposure to the material, and then you send the students to their rooms to go over the material, make sense of it, and create a deep understanding. If you stop to think about it, we spend all our time as instructors on the easy part, the information transfer. This is the century, there's really no excuse for that. Ever since Gutenberg invented the printing press, there have been good methods for transferring information. So let's flip that around and ask the students to take the responsibility for the first exposure in their rooms so that we can use the time with them in the classroom to build a deeper understanding. I've sort of done that with construction and Twitter and living learning analytics. Some of you know about that, and it's been sort of growing worldwide as a movement. But this created an opportunity to also rethink the information transfer part. So I'm going to talk about three things. I'm going to talk about the information crash, maybe code of class, I'm going to talk about the conscience, which essentially are the Trojan horse. And lastly, I'm going to talk about the inconscience, and then we're going to wrap up some data that we have collected over the past few years. So let's start with the information transfer. I've been eliminated this. How do I replace it? Over the 20-some years that I did pre-instruction in science at the BUC, I first asked this question to read the book. Then in order to provide the next little stick, I said, read the book and I'm going to give you a quiz. And then later when I found that this extrinsic motivation wasn't really good, I adopted the technique called just-in-time teaching, which sort of has not just a stick, but also a carrot in order to get them to do the reading. But I realized that I spent all of my time working hard on making the in-class experience a social experience. Pre-instruction, as students teach each other, interact with each other in the classroom, and deep down, learning is a social experience, not an individual experience. In fact, it's so strange, right? I mean, if you stop to think about it, all of education is focused on the individual, both in the teaching as well as in the assessment. Even though society is all, it's a completely collaborative experience. No wonder we produce people who, you know, are very good working alone, but then when they get out in the workspace, it turns out they don't have the requisite collaborative skills to flourish. So anyway, so I said, you know, we have to make the out-of-class component also a social threat. So we have the platform, which is now online, widely available, Google, which we can actually guarantee every student there for every class. And it's like essentially a social learning platform. The students log in, so we are the first social network, and then once they're on there, they can see who else is online, and they go through that show up. And if they read the book, they can check the time button. There's always a chat window where you can ask a question. That question is staged, and after a while, it needs to be marked up. You can click on any of these markups, and it shows the dialogue of the students. I mean, if you're in a little bit of an issue, I don't think you can read it, but I'll read it to you. Just one student brought a book in front of me last semester at midnight, said, I don't understand how this combination of tests does anything about the rest, blah, blah, blah. Then 20 minutes later, or 30 minutes later, another student said, I think you may be able to think about the direction separately, and so on. And 2 days later, another student said, this is a great question, further elaborate. So what you see here is, in essence, an online version of the assessment. The asynchronous interaction between students helping each other understand the material. Initially, we dove in, because, you know, when you read that, your fingers are itching to dive into the discussion. I quickly discovered that's the wrong thing to do. The ownership of the discussion is to guide the students. Because as soon as you dive in, they take whatever you're asking them to say as the gospel, and they very quickly start to expect you to answer all of their questions, and no longer take the trouble of answering each other's question as thoroughly as you might want. Okay, well, I could tell you much more about it. I'm just going to tell you that we use a combination of intrinsic and extrinsic factors to motivate students to participate, and that we get, in an average course that we teach, which is about 60-some students, 20,000 annotations. The students write more text than the author, me, in the stage, has written in the book, and I took 25 years to do that. Okay, so let's talk about the projects. How do these language projects, right? We've had many labs and our specific courses, and in a sense, language exercises are like mini projects, but they're hardly motivating. The next thing, you think of a project that you do for the entire semester in the fall and then another one in the spring, but how do you capture the entire curriculum in one big project? I end up settling essentially on three projects per semester, six for the entire year, one in a month, so that I could partition the curriculum into three bits. We form teams, we do not let the students choose who they work with. In the real world, you don't choose who you work with either. So we basically engineer the teams so that have diversified students according to interest, abilities, and another part of measures. That's what I'm more detailed on later on. Now, in order to design the project, I learned a lot from this school. I went to serve a number of classes there. And the business school, which makes money after others, developing and selling cases throughout a business school, has a set of design criteria for the cases. And it turned out that those design criteria